But we're going to start with an interview that I actually recorded a couple hours ago. And we recorded it mostly for logistics sake, because Ali Velshi and others at MSNBC and other news organizations are working pretty screwy hours these days. So he never knows when he's going to be on call. There, you know, everything's all messed up. So we figured we both had a good chunk of time today at around noon. So he hopped on Skype from his home and I hopped on it from my home studio. And we recorded this interview. And the way it came about was just a little, I'm a bitch. I'm such a bitch sometimes on social media. And I called out Ali for something. And I've long been a fan of his. I really do appreciate his work. And I think he's one of a very small handful of people at MSNBC who I truly, truly respect and enjoy watching and listening to. So I felt badly when I sort of had a little tussle with him on Twitter. But he handled it beautifully. And we became buds and we exchanged emails. And I invited him on the show. And, well, here's how it went. Joining me on the line now is Ali Velshi. He's somebody that, well, we welcome into our homes all the time. I've become a big fan of Ali Velshi's. In fact, I started really following you, Ali, when you joined Al Jazeera America, because I was excited that for the first time in this era, we had a news channel that was about news. It wasn't about, one ideology over another. The goal there was to present news in an objective manner, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was two goals. One is news in the absence of, what we used to think of as news, being as objective as possible. And we can discuss what objectivity is, because I think we've learned over time that maybe it's not exactly what we think it is. But that was one of the goals. And the other goal that I thought was really important is because I'd been a journalist probably 20 some odd years before I joined Al Jazeera. And we were really concentrated on telling stories from the perspective of the voiceless, or being a voice for the voiceless. And it occurred to me, while I had always thought about those things, and I thought I was reporting about those things, my life as a journalist in New York City working for mainstream media doesn't expose me to a whole lot of voiceless people as we go out of our way to find them. Mm-hmm. Even our most junior employees at a media organization are powerful, right? Because they can call up anybody and tell them they're from the media. Right. So it caused me to get outside of a zone in which I had been operating. It wasn't a shift in ideology for me or the way I think about things, but it really caused me to say, how do you tell stories from the perspective of the very people who don't have the voice, whom you talk about, whom you analyze, whom you characterize all the time? And I have to say, Nicole, that was a bigger challenge than a guy like me thought it was going to be. I thought this was obvious, right? I know who these voiceless people are. I know what their challenges are. I know what their lives are. Well, I didn't. Mm-hmm. And it changed my perspective. It was a remarkable experience for me for that reason.
And then, unfortunately, as these things happen, Al Jazeera didn't catch on here. Do you think it was more, because I enjoyed watching them. I like the objectivity. I'm always looking for it because it helps me organize my thoughts so I can be more objective about what I cover. And my show is not objective news coverage. It's opinion and commentary, but always based in fact. That's got to be the underlying basis. Otherwise, it's worthless. So I was bummed when it went away. And I wonder how much of it was xenophobia, was the fact that Al Jazeera was an Arabic network that was based in Qatar. And was that a big part of it?
So, you know, the other day, somebody tweeted me something that was meant to be criticism and said, you know, how'd that Al Jazeera thing work out for you? And I said, did you watch it? And they said, no, I never did. It was biased. And I said, so you never watched anything on Al Jazeera America? And he said, no. And I said, would you mind looking some stuff up for me and letting me know what you thought was biased about that? And so that was the problem. Those people who watched, even if they had political biases, we had people watching us who were conservative, who were liberal, but they felt that they could get the news. And those people who never did think so. And part of that was that logo, which was remarkable Arabic calligraphy. It was a competition that somebody won many years ago design the Al Jazeera logo, which to the untrained eye, including mine, looks a whole lot like ISIS's logo, frankly.
Mm-hmm.
We are not familiar with Arabic. We're certainly not familiar with Arabic calligraphy.
Nope.
And we're not familiar with Arabic anything, right? In North American society, there is no car, there is no chewing gum, there is no soft drink. Arabic to Americans for the last 25 years has, generally speaking, been associated with bad things, terrorism, Al-Qaeda, stuff like that. And that was very difficult to overcome. So I think that was a lot of it. So I don't think it's that people watched it and objected to it. I think the people who watched it actually came around to the idea that it was pretty good. There were some people who would just never watch it.
Exactly.
There were some carriers that would never carry it.
Yeah, it's that. It's the inbred bigotry. It's that institutional racism. Now, you, Ali Velshi, have made no secret of your background. You're a Kenyan-born Muslim who then grew up in Canada, is now living and working here in the States. And I'm guessing that you've gotten both, kudos for that and some criticism, because people are like that.
It comes up every few weeks. Somebody will tweet it, as if it's a criticism. It's like it's in my Twitter bio.
Right.
I was actually just annoyed because for a long time I was the most famous Kenyan-born Muslim I knew until Barack Obama showed up on the scene. I say it tongue in cheek to say I'm actually that guy, and he was never at any of the meetings.
Exactly.
To me, I did grow up in a world in which varied experience and diversity is of value. And that can be from anywhere. That could be socioeconomic, where you are, where you're from, what you speak, what color you are, what gender you are, what you identify with. So I've never, ever, ever thought of that as a negative, right? To me, it's like, list the stuff you are and let people make with it, make what they will of it. Today, the concept of being foreign, immigrant, Muslim, global in perspective, Canada, some people associate with socialist. It's fascinating the buckets people will quickly put you into. I'm not actually that complex of being. I just sort of put it out there to say, hey, this is, if you wonder where my thinking comes from, if you wonder why I support single payer, healthcare, it's not actually a Bernie Sanders thing to me. It's the system in which I grew up. It's the system that I've studied, and it seems to work. That it happened to align for a few minutes with Bernie Sanders' campaign is interesting, but that's not where it came from with me. So I put it out there to say, whatever you think I think, because I'm a Kenyan-born Muslim who grew up in Canada, you're probably right.
Or not, because you're a human being, and you're here, and for me, first and foremost, as a viewer and a power consumer of news media, you're one of the best. Now, I know we met virtually through Twitter some time ago when one morning I was in a pissy mood and I probably hadn't had enough coffee. And you said, I'm a big Bernie Sanders supporter for some of the reasons you already mentioned, the single payer and just his consistency over the years. And one morning, and it was like maybe only your second week in the new slot in the new Velshi show, which is now on Saturdays and Sundays from 8 to 10 Eastern morning. I'm, one of those old people who doesn't sleep and wakes up early in the morning, so I see it all the time. Anyway, I called you out in a pissy moment, and you were so wonderful in the way you responded to me, and you really engaged with me. Some of your colleagues have blocked me over the years, and rightly so, probably. I blocked some of them, but I was so thrilled to have this conversation with you, and it verified my belief in that you're a good guy, you're a decent human being, and you're smart. And that's one of the reasons I enjoy watching you, because you do give a very well-rounded view of the whatever story you're talking about. You give background, and you do it without much personal commentary invoked, although not that there's anything wrong with that. I do it on a daily basis, but you give us the facts, and especially at a time like this, that is so important. And that's one of the things I wanted to talk to you about today, is how life reporting on the news has changed when we're living the biggest news story any of us has ever even imagined. The idea of a pandemic was always out there, and obviously the administration had been briefed on it too, not that they took it seriously, but we as a people, as a planet, have never lived through anything like this. How has it changed your world, other than obviously in the mechanics we see in the coverage and you're working from home? In a bigger picture, how has it changed you?
Well, on a few levels, first of all, for your comment, I don't really recall our fight. I recall the resolution. I recall the fact that we decided to engage and have a conversation. To me, that's the good part, right? I'm fine with criticism. We should often have it. And by the way, I think I was one of Bernie Sanders' last interviews before he stepped out of the race.
And I have to thank you for that too, by the way, because that did not go unnoticed, and it was a great interview too. So thank you for that.
We had a great interview, and I've always enjoyed a great relationship with the senator editorially, and I like that. So a lot of things have changed. I've covered a lot of the very big stories of our time. Right? I've covered the I covered 9/11. I covered the recession. I covered various, you know, I've covered hurricanes and earthquakes and wars. This is so different. Never mind the mechanics, which is fascinating, right? I'm broadcasting from my home right now. Actually, one of my colleagues, a photographer, is here adjusting some lighting and fixing some things. But the mechanics aside of anchoring a show, there's that. Then there's the actual news gathering, right? The idea that we have to tell real people stories. And that means going into places where real people are. And that this is a time when that's just weird, right? People don't necessarily want you coming into their homes. We're not out there all the time. So this Skype, Zoom, things like that have become much more valuable. But remember that we as a network operate on the basis that we have contacts who have our companies, who have communications experts. That regular folks don't have that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So social media, Twitter, the stories about people's lives have become crucial and important. Frontline workers, right? I get outside in Manhattan at 7 p.m. every day and clap for those people out there, the frontline workers, including the grocery delivery people, the doormen, the nurses. But I don't talk to them. I don't interview them. So we've had to find ways to do that. And we do that. We are talking to home health care aides and grocery store workers and people like that to tell us how what impact this has on them. And I think that's a part of our the new way we think about things that is going to be good. Right. Maybe we can tell a lot more stories from the bottom up than we can from the perspective of presidents and princes and prime ministers down. So that's one very good part about this. But the other thing about it that's fascinating is in the big stories that I've covered, even in 9/11, we thought it was existential. We thought it was going to be a massive threat to our way of life. And ultimately it was, and it wasn't going to destroy us. And in the recession, we thought about all the ways in which it was going to damage our lives and our prosperity, but we weren't scared of the people around us. Mm-hmm. This is so new. You don't know where this threat lies. So your brain can't get your head around who fixes this. How does it get fixed? This is science. This is leadership. This is government. And we don't know how to process that. So we're doing it in real time. And you'll notice every single week on TV, our behavior changes a little bit because the story has shifted. Is it about fear? Is it about numbers? Is it about leadership? Is it about the economy? Is it about failures in government? Is it about medical science? So it's such a fast evolving story about things around which we don't have a pre-established expertise.
Right. And what I'm noticing also is we're all being affected by this in ways that we probably won't even know for months and maybe in some cases years to come. And I'm talking about mental health. And I'm somebody, I've been open about this on my show. I have always struggled with depression my entire adult life since adolescence. And I had a really, really rough time after Donald Trump's election, where I had I can look back now and describe it as a breakdown. I did my job. I did a show every day. Don't ask me how I got through it. I'm afraid if I were to go back and listen to some of those shows, I'd be mortified because I got to the point where I'd had to write out every word. I was a nervous wreck. I questioned everything. And this is something I've been doing for 40 years. I've been in radio and I would shake before I opened the mic. It so thoroughly destroyed me. And I somehow got through it, came out on the other side, maybe seeing, all right, we're coming closer to an election time and maybe we can get rid of this man. But it has really affected me. And now, you know, just when we thought things couldn't get any worse, really, as a nation, as a planet, we're not going to go any lower, we get hit by this pandemic. And so many of us are just, I'm a lung cancer survivor and I'm 60 years old. I can't go out there. So it's changed every aspect of our lives. And it's changed the way I do my show, because no longer do I want to dig down deep on all the numbers and the news and the, it's too much. I want,
that's what we know.
Right. So I'm hitting on a more human level. I think I mentioned this to you in an email. I happened upon a Facebook group called View From My Room that now in a short month has over 1 million members who people at every corner of the planet, they take pictures of the view from their house, say where they are. They're everywhere from Zimbabwe to South Africa to Australia, New Zealand, and Bolivia and Brazil and all over the States. And I'm looking at these and I start reaching out to some of these people and connecting with them. And I've invited them on the show. So I'm doing this new segment called Quarantine Calling, where I connected yesterday with a wonderful woman from Finland, somebody else in Denmark, somebody in Italy. And it just, it's a small world. And we're all on this in a unique moment in history when we're all experiencing basically the same thing. And I'm having a hard time verbalizing what that is, but just trying to connect with people. Those kind of stories are what somehow make me feel a little better, and it gives me a way to pass things along to listeners. Are you more interested in stuff like that? Or because we also need you to help explain about the PPP program running out of money and why some of us haven't gotten our $1,200 yet.
Yeah. And that is what we still do and what we still should do. But I have had segments on my shows that I have not had on my shows in 25 years or 30 years of doing this. I had an expert on grief the other day, talking about the collective grief we all feel, not just the grief of those of us who have lost somebody to COVID, but the loss, the feeling that we feel about the loss of normalcy in our lives actually feels like grief. And then there are those people who've lost somebody during this period, not to coronavirus, but they can't have a funeral, or they can't be with them, or they can't have a memorial service. I talked to somebody the other day about what young LGBTQ people go through, right? Because let's say you've had to leave school or leave your work and quarantine in place with your family, which wasn't safe space for you to start with.
Yeah.
I had someone talking about people who are abused in their relationships. Where do you go when
those
you
got
to actually be with someone and you can't run to the shelter and you don't have places that are open to you? So, you know, we would give them tips as to what to do. What do you do if you suffer from anxiety? Or first of all, we're all sufferers of anxiety now. Those of us who didn't appreciate what anxiety was when people, you know, when you said, well, that's not really rational what your fear of that
of
is.
Not.
It's like, guess what? We're all irrationally fearful all the time. Thank you for talking openly about your depression, because for people who are suffering from these things, this becomes that much more complicated. You don't have the same access to either therapists or medication or doctors that you typically have. And when everybody else is anxious, how do you share those concerns with people? And I feel like that is immediate and in the center of this conversation and necessary. We started running an ad on MSNBC probably 3 weeks ago. You know, we have this series that's called This Is Who We Are.
And
we changed it to We Are In This Together. And it was just imagery of around the world and in America, the things people do to help other people in these times and to cope. I've invited people. I have a email address, mystory@velshi.com, to just tell me, how are you coping? Good, bad, send me videos, send me pictures. And we tell that story every show. I do an obituary every show. Just to remember that these are real people's lives that were lived. And my producer, Emma, writes it and she sends it to me and I read it. And I always smile because the stories are so good. And then I always cry when I deliver them on TV. I've read it already. I know what it's going to say. And yet I can't keep it together. So these are ways in which we have changed. But I do agree with you. We have learned to find strength in each other. And that doesn't mean that you and I shouldn't argue on Twitter or we shouldn't have political arguments. I think we should. Somebody said to me last night, I did a webinar, and they said, do you think we can put aside our political bickering as we lead into the election to deal with this? And I said, no.
Yeah.
I said, people died for our right to politically bicker. You may call it bickering, and sometimes it feels like bickering, and sometimes it feels small and petty. But it is actually central to who we are. So for all we hate about coronavirus and being stuck in our homes, think about those people in the world who don't also have an election coming That's up right. in which they can vote, who don't have freedoms, who live in a refugee camp, who have no money at all, who live in abject poverty and can't do the things that we can do to social distance and keep clean all the time. We have democracy and we have a vote. And it's this is not the time to shy away from our adulthood and our democratic rights and our constitutional obligations for free speech. So bicker and fix coronavirus at the same time. We can actually walk and chew gum at the same time.
Most definitely. But then there's the other aspect that we've steered clear of so far, but it's the 239-pound and then some elephant in the room by way of Donald Trump, who if you knew that we were going to be struck with a global pandemic of these proportions, this scary, who is the last person you'd want in the White House? Right. Donald Trump. And yet he goes up there, he commandeers two and a half hours of prime television time every night. I know MSNBC has gotten a little better at pulling away from him and trying to fact check him in real time. But to have him spout some of the crap he's spouting off is just so irresponsible and frightening. And it's, you know, my husband, I watch it because I say I have to. It's my job. I need to know what he's saying. And my husband can't be in the room. It's making him nuts. This is another aspect. I watch the way he berates journalists just doing their job. And if you're not complimentary of him, if you don't couch your question with praise, he'll call you the worst names that no adult should ever call anybody, let alone the president of the United States. I wonder on a daily basis, why don't these people get up and walk out? And then I answer my question and I say, because then all that would be left covering him is Fox and OANN. And that's as much of a disservice as covering this stuff.
The two things I always think journalists have to do, one is to bear witness, right? To tell people something is happening. And then you think about the Yazidis on Mount Sinjar, or you think about Darfur, or you think about the Rohingya. If there weren't somebody to tell you it was happening, we actually wouldn't know, because we'd all be on our feeds, which we have curated for ourselves, and the story wouldn't get there. So part of the reason we have to be in that room is to bear witness. Even if it's incredibly hard to watch. This is the president of the United States that was elected by American people, and the consequence of having that president is having that president, and we have to tell you that. But the other really important thing that you're getting at is the other responsibility that journalists have is to speak truth to power, to hold power to account. And there are some journalists in that room who on a daily basis, and by the way, it's not like anchoring a show where you've booked your guests, you know who they are, you've done research, you had a booker look into them, you've got a segment producer, you've read their articles. You have no idea on a daily basis what Donald Trump is going to do.
Nope.
And his mind works very differently than mine does. So I give a little extra credence to those reporters in that room, because he says stuff and then you have to decide, am I holding him to account for the thing that I thought I was holding him account for? Did he just say something really weird that I need to challenge, or do I need to get information on what they know? So it's hard. And there are some reporters, my friend Yamiche Alcindor from PBS, one of them, who, you know, he picks on her all the time. He belittles her all the time. He's got some bee in his bonnet about her, and she holds her patience and continues to ask her questions. And the other day when he skipped past her because he didn't want to give her another question, a couple reporters later, Jeremy Diamond from CNN took his opportunity and gave her the mic back.
Yes.
So there are some moments of glory in these things. But somebody said something to me before coronavirus when I was anchoring on Friday nights. I anchor Lawrence O'Donnell's show.
Right.
Last Word. And she came on and she said, This is for grownups. This is not a time when you can say, this person's going to come in and save me. Mm-hmm. That's now not going to happen. So you are going to do the things you have to do, the most powerful of which remains your vote, others of which remain keeping your family safe, keeping yourself safe, social distancing where necessary, finding those around you who need resources, who you can help either figure out how to get their $1,200 or figure out how to file for unemployment, or if they don't file for unemployment, what can you do to help those around you? I have seen acts of kindness that I didn't know possible in the last couple of months. Just people saying, do you need money? Mm-hmm. Tweet me, need money. What you just said about talking to people, random people around the world, people saying, call me if you need someone to talk to. We're going to fix ourselves. We're going to take the mantle of leadership. And I will say one thing. When Joe Biden launched his campaign, he talked about recapturing the soul of America, and he talked about Charlottesville and how far we've come. You know, he's changed his whole theme now, and he's talking about who he's going to pick for his cabinet.
Yeah.
And if you think back to 2008, during the election, during the financial crisis, John McCain had been doing pretty well, and then he picked Sarah Palin as his running mate. And Barack Obama lined up with all of Clinton's senior economic advisors behind him. Basically, this is going to be the team that's going to help me out. And Joe Biden switched strategy to say, look, maybe you've got doubts about who I am or what my actual capabilities are, but I'm going to start to line up a team for you so you know who is going to lead you out of that. Interesting theory, given that America right now is so hungry for leadership. So that I think we're all pivoting and we're all making adjustments to say, you can watch that White House press briefing every day. Your solution and your leadership's not going to come from there. So find it where you can and find it in yourself if you can.
Right. Well, hopefully. I mean, then there are those of us waiting on the edges saying, OK, who Joe Biden assembles is of the utmost importance. If he goes back to the old well and brings in Larry Summers and Tim Geithner and the same old Clinton Obama crew, that's not going to do the trick. He needs to. I've already said I've got my industrial strength nose clips from my lung cancer battle that I used for pulmonary testing. I used this in 2016 to vote for Hillary Clinton, and I'm planning to use it again to vote for Joe Biden. But I want to know that he's talking with the Sanders camp and the Warren camp, and that they're going to take our wants and considerations into effect. I would love to see Joe Biden right now announce his running mate because, he's no spring chicken. That person could likely be president. So that's an important consideration. And I want to know who else he's going to surround himself with. And I just hope that I wish he would use this time to bring in people and say, these are the people I'm looking at. Do you think, all the rules are thrown out. Everything is going to have to change now. Is that a possibility?
Yeah, I wonder. The running mate question is a big one, and I don't know whether he'll move quickly on that. But I think the way around that, if he weren't going to move quickly around this, is to sort of say this is what the cabinet looks like. Now, that's going to be weird, because if all of a sudden there isn't a Kamala Harris or there isn't an Elizabeth Warren or there isn't somebody like that, does that just put the running mate conversation into overdrive to say, well, he's kept them because such and such? So I don't know how he's thinking about that. I sort of agree with you conceptually that it might be time for Joe Biden, who now is the presumptive nominee, to just act like the presumptive nominee, to act like we're in October, not in April. And I think he's getting that message. And I also think it sounds like from the conversations people have been having, including with Bernie Sanders and with Elizabeth Warren and with Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, that the Joe Biden campaign is taking that part of the message seriously. Look, there are things about the Bernie Sanders campaign which were considered quite radical a few years ago that are now mainstream.
That's right.
$15 an hour, people, is $30,000 a year. So everybody who thinks that the socialists are taking over and the poor are taking your money, it's $30,000 a year.
Exactly.
The minimum wage is 7.25. That's $15,000 a year. I saw a poll the other day that said 30% of people who identify as conservatives think that universal health care might be a good thing. And I've argued for a long time it actually shouldn't be a liberal or a conservative idea. It's actually a better idea that gets you a better return on your investment. So when you take all of that together, I think that there are things that we thought that now people are saying, you know what, if we had universal health care, we'd probably be in a better position today because there would be a whole bunch of people with underlying conditions who would seek treatment. And who might not die of coronavirus or might not go to work because they could afford to be at home and make somebody else sick. So You know, I think the world has changed a lot in the last couple of months.
I hope so. And one of the things my calling around the world, I hope, brings to light, I always ask the people in these other countries about their healthcare systems. And, you know, they're always, they know what it is over here. But when I mention the insurance card and it's tied to your employment, and then there's copays and deductibles, and the people who don't have insurance go back, it is inconceivable to the rest of the civilized world. If we have one silver lining from this whole mess, hopefully we keep the deaths down, they keep the curve flat, people, yeah, you know, the horror is minimized as much as it can be. But we come out on the other end with people knowing that, yeah, we need universal health care. We need a single-payer health care system.
Yeah, and look, you think about how many of our major policies have come out of bad things. That's not a bad thing to wish for, right? The idea that good things come out of bad things. The triangle shirtwaist factory meant that workers don't work in rooms that are locked, so that if there's a fire, they can't get out. People had to die for us to say, wow, that seems to be a no-brainer, and there are lots of places in the world who don't have basic rules like that. That's so right. I think that, you know, I used to report on hurricanes, and I'd talk about climate change, and people would say, this isn't the time. And I've reported on so many mass shootings on site, and people have said, this isn't the time to talk about gun control. Well, guess what? It's actually always the time to talk about ways in which we can handle this thing that's happening now differently and better in the future. So I think we can hold both of those thoughts together. We're in a crisis, and rule number one is fix that. But let's talk about how we fix this moving forward.
Absolutely. Ali Velshi, I could keep talking to you for an hour. I know I've overstayed my welcome already. Thank you so much. What a pleasure this has been. I do enjoy waking up and watching you weekend mornings. And it's even better when someone's out and I see it's you in the fill-in chair, because I trust you and I like you. And now I think you're a friend. So Ali Velshi, find him. His website is velshi.com. He's on Twitter at Ali Velshi. And of course, you find him on MSNBC pretty much all the time, but certainly Saturday and Sunday mornings from 8 to 10 Eastern. What a pleasure this has been. Thank you so much. It was great meeting you.
Thanks. You too.